All right, and welcome back to the Old School MMA Reviews review of the Ultimate 2 from 1996. This is part 2. If you missed part 1, what the hell are you doing here? Go back and watch part 1. If you have watched part 1, welcome back. We are here now to look at Panther's DVDs, as we mentioned in the end of part 1, because I wanted to check and see if they actually exist, and Zane is like thinking, what the hell are we doing on this show now?
Yeah, no, we're not gonna actually like watch these, are we? I don't really need to watch Gary Goodridge teach me an armbar.
I think he actually had a series as well. I'm on Century Fitness's or Century Martial Arts's page right now, and they still actually have a section for Panther DVDs. So I'm gonna have to include a link, I guess, in the post about this. But unfortunately for you, they don't have much of anything anymore in the Panther DVD section. It's actually really slim pickings.
Yeah, it's kind of disappointing. You showed it to me, and I was all waiting for, like, Tank Abbott's cardio routine, and they didn't have it.
Yeah, unfortunately, all they have right now in their quote-unquote extreme section is Boss Rutten's Extreme Pancrase series, which is $14.99 each. And FYI, I actually do recommend the Extreme Pancrase series. It's actually still a very, very good instructional set from Boss Rutten, because frankly, anything Boss does is always good. And they also still have Rob Common. They have his Muay Thai DVD series, which is also a really good series. And there's like one or two Gracie series in the Jiu-Jitsu stuff. I do not recommend the Gracie stuff. They're just like so rudimentary and basic. It's not worth your money. But yeah, disappointing, because they used to have such a huge selection. They actually had Don Frye. They had Oleg Taktarov. I actually had Don Frye and Oleg Taktarov tapes as well. I don't have those anymore, but I had those tapes. I had Chemo, as I mentioned. And just to prove it to you, I went digging around, and this is the first time it's ever been shown on camera.
Oh, yeah. Exclusive.
Yes, this is one of the various archives I have. I've got like a ton of these. It's covered in dust. This is one of the many DVD archives I have. This is loaded with various DVDs of martial arts events. Wow, look at all this crap. It's very dusty. That was not supposed to happen. Yeah, so this has got like K1, Pride, UFC stuff, all sorts of various things, documentaries, Ultimate Fighter seasons. And then hiding in the back, we have Panther Classic. All right. I have no idea what this is, though, because it's not labeled very well.
Okay, well, there goes my next question out the window.
Yeah, I think this might be Gene LaBelle's DVDs, because Gene LaBelle had a pretty good series. But yeah, you can't tell because these things didn't come in a package. It just says on it, Grappling Product 001. So that could be anything.
Martial arts training could be gay porn.
I'm hoping it's the latter. Anyway, that'll be an exciting show. What else do I have? I've got Mercur's DVD series as well. I got a few of these. That was called Seek and Destroy. I highly recommend that if you can find it on eBay because those are really good takedown DVDs. He doesn't go over too many takedowns, but he goes over it in extreme detail. I've got Rob Common in here, and I think that's all I have in this one, but I know I've also got a bunch of others, and I think it's really friggin' heavy. And yeah, if you guys are actually training, I really recommend trying to find these old Panther DVDs, because they're, number one, they're just like great historical pieces, and they actually are pretty informative, even though they probably don't age that well for the most part, especially anything the Gracies did with Panther and Century. But, Century later on did a really good series with Frank Shamrock, Randy Couture, Jens Pulver, and Matt Hughes. I recommend those. So, yeah, we'll talk about instructionals another day when we actually finally review the UFC instructional tape series. I just wanted to show that off because I'm a nerd and I buy a lot of this crap. So, anyway, Ultimate, Zane. What's up?
Yeah, that was really interesting. Oh, man. Sorry, dozed out. Okay, Ultimate, yes.
You know, I quit this show and I quit you. Goodbye.
Oh, you can't quit me, Matt.
You're right, I can't.
All right. So we got another
Such
promo
an abusive
for
relationship
Judgment.
We have.
What?
Such an abusive relationship we have.
I know. Yeah, but you know, you keep coming back, so I assume you like it.
It's a vicious cycle.
It is. So, in between the Varlins and Chemo fight, and the next bout up, which is Tank Abbott versus Steve Nelmark, because as we know, Ken Shamrock was injured. Ken Shamrock versus Tank Abbott in this event would have been bananas. That would have been pretty awesome.
That shit is bananas. B-A-N-A-N-A-S.
Yep.
Gwen Stefani.
Now I'm quitting the show. Oh.
And that's how Old School MMA Reviews ends. With a whimper, not a bang.
Okay, so in between there, we got an interview with... We got another plug for Judgment Day. Teasing out that Dan Severn will be on it. That's our trickle of information. Dan Severn, we know, will be on it. And Scott Ferrozzo, because God damn it, if that just doesn't get the blood flowing.
That gets my nipples hard and pointy, let me tell you. Hearing Scott Ferrozzo will be back, I cannot wait. To be fair, I actually am kind of looking forward to seeing Scott Ferrozzo come back, but not to actually push him as part of the pay-per-view, like, you know, come pay money.
Yeah, I would look forward to another Scott Ferrozzo fight, just like I would look forward to another Paul Varland fight, but I wouldn't, like, promote something or sell something on the basis of Scott Ferrozzo or Paul Varland's.
Yeah, or Dan Severn, really, but that's a different argument.
Yeah, that's something else altogether. But, so we got our promo, and then we get an interview with John McCarthy. That's terrible. Halfway terrible.
This is Tony Blauer's big blunder of the night, or one of the two big blunders he has. Cause he's only on camera like three times, and
yeah,
he finds a way to mess it up every time he appears on camera. And he's interviewing Big John McCarthy, and he asks him about the Cal Worsham fight, and that's literally how he asks him. He's like, so, Cal Worsham fight.
Yeah. And McCarthy proceeds to give a complete play-by-play of the fight that we just saw.
Yeah, it's pretty bad. I mean, it's not like they were taking a break to look at Panther Classic DVDs. They were actually
No.
It was like, you know what? It was like probably 20 seconds after the fight ended, and Big John's back there, and he's doing this interview that's really hard to listen to. And then he asks him, you know, like about the ending, and then Big John's like, "Yeah, what about the ending?" And we basically get more, even though we already kind of know what happens. He explains again that Cal was upset about the cheap shot after the fight. That's really all there is to it. There's not like there's any further drama. And
well,
I guess
was actually happy about the Cal Worsham Tank Abbott part of it. It was more like what I was thinking. Sorry, you totally threw me there. Because what I was thinking about was the whole time he spent totally giving play-by-play for Leopoldo versus Varlins.
That's right, yeah, I forgot about that, yeah. So that's how forgettable it was. It was a very, like, you know, bland
interview. Yeah, the first half of it, he just gives play-by-play for Abbott for Varlins versus Leopoldo. Just completely rehashes the whole 9-minute fight. And then, forgettable guy, whose name now I'm forgetting. He's that forgettable.
Tony Blauer. We just said his name 15 seconds ago.
Yeah. Asked McCarthy, what about Worsham? And yeah, McCarthy just says, what about him? And we are forced into a horribly awkward silence as Bauer tries to milk a little bit more information out of McCarthy about Worsham Abbott, which I actually found that helpful, just as a reinforcement.
Yeah, that was a good thing to have on air. It was just done so awkwardly, and you know, it wasn't quite Bill Wallace quality of awkward and terribleness, but it was getting pretty close, because, you know, Blauer was handling himself pretty well, but he just stumbled. He didn't quite know how to actually present the questions, or how to present questions at all in that case.
Yeah, and let's be clear, too, McCarthy was being a little bit of a dick, just kind of being like, if you're not going to ask me the right questions, I'm not going to give you anything worth putting on TV.
Yeah, because he was basically like smiling as he was like being like, you know, what do you want to know about it?
Yeah.
Dick move, Big John. Dick move.
Dick move, Big John. That's right.
So, yeah, so, I guess we can go ahead now, because that's pretty much it. That's our first bit of filler, and that lasted a few minutes. And that brings us now to our first fight in the second round of this tournament. And, we've now lost, like, half the guys that are moving ahead, because instead of having Ken Shamrock versus Tank Abbott, we were robbed of that amazing super fight. And now we have Steve Nelmark stepping in to replace Shamrock to take on Tank Abbott. And that gives us one of the most memorable knockouts in UFC history ever.
Does. This is one of those things that, and you don't even see it coming in the fight. Like, you could know it's going to happen, and you just don't see it coming at all. And it's an iconic UFC knockout. I mean, it's one of a couple of things that made Tank Abbott have any sort of highlight reel at all and any kind of name value at all for years to come.
And also is how we got the phrase Nelmarked out of the mixed martial arts world.
I didn't even know about that phrase, so...
No one really says it anymore. It used to be a thing back in the day. Like the tough season one days, we still used to say that word.
Well, certainly Rashad Evans got Nelmarked.
Yes, and we could also say that Crow Cop got Nelmarked by Gonzaga in the past.
Yes, he did. But this was, it was just sort of... Obviously, it was bad from the first moment you knew that something bad was going to happen to Nelmark. When he and Abbott trade punches where they each, they throw a punch at the same time and both their punches land. And Abbott just stands there and Nelmark flies back about 10 feet into the cage wall. It's like, at that point, you know that this is not going to go well for Steve.
Yeah, I mean, at this point, we don't really know that much about Nelmark. We do get a quick replay of his preliminary fight earlier in the night, which he got a takedown on, who was it? I believe it was Ty Bowden. Was that who he fought? I'm trying to remember who it was.
Yeah,
it was Ty Bowden.
No, Marcus Bossett.
Marcus Bossett, okay, yeah. He beat Ty Bowden at an earlier event.
Yeah.
In his first appearance, which is, I think, at UFC 9.
Yeah.
And so at this one, he fought Bossett, and he basically got a really easy but sloppy takedown against Bossett, and essentially just headbutted the crap out of him. So this is Nelmark's strategy, is get the guy down and headbutt them. I guess it's Mark Kerr before Mark Kerr existed, but anyway, that was basically his strategy, just a headbutt. So we already know off the bat that Nelmark is not going to be a strategic fighter, and this is going to be a bang and not a technical fight whatsoever. And like you said, yeah, they both came out swinging, but it was immediately noticeable who was going to be the victor in this one.
This is also actually, and I think this is where, and Tank hits another big body slam in this fight.
Yeah, he held him up this time. They were done mauling each other for a little bit, Tank picked him up, held him up in the air, and then just slammed him to the ground. I guess it's not quite as memorable because it wasn't quite as high up as the last one we just saw, and then the fact that Nelmark did manage to get back to his feet, but it was still another enormous Tank Abbott takedown, and that's, once again, pretty impressive of Tank going 0-60 and then going back to 0, because he looked pretty sluggish as soon as the fight actually started. Like, he just kind of walked to the center of the cage.
Yeah. And certainly, and like I said, because, yeah, any fight over a minute is basically using up Tank Abbott's gas tank at this point. And even in this fight, like, before the knockout comes, so he picks Nelmark up, slams him down, Nelmark gets back up, and Tank Abbott starts winging this flurry of punches at him, and each one starts to come just a little bit slower until he just kind of stops and clinches Nelmark up against the cage and is just sitting there for, like, 10 seconds. So he pulls his arm out and unloads just a vicious, vicious right hand that puts Nelmark out like he got shot.
He basically just collapses onto himself. It looks horrible. To this day, it still looks terrible. It's a vicious, vicious knockout. And if you haven't seen it, do yourself a favor and go find that knockout online somewhere. Because if you haven't seen it by now, what the hell's wrong with you? Classic UFC knockout. And it's just crazy because you really look back at the whole fight itself. It was a great showing for Tank Abbott, even though it's a nobody, whatever. Tank looks incredibly dominant, and he is. And Nelmark was basically out on his feet at least 20 seconds before this match was even over. I think Tank just being so tired and leaning on Nelmark essentially also helped keep him on his feet. keep Nelmark on his feet. That's how bad it was. Like, Nelmark was done. This fight should have been over even earlier. It shouldn't have come to the point where it did. But it did, and that's pretty great for us because we have a wonderful highlight reel moment to remember forever of Tank Abbott.
Yeah. Yeah, it was a great short fight. But a lot of fun.
Seconds.
Yep, and it's another, it's a fight that really, like I say, there is a legacy to be had for Tank Abbott, and unfortunately for him, this event was kind of like the end of that legacy.
I can agree with that. I mean, from here, it really is downhill, and that's sad to say, because, we're not done seeing Tank Abbott in MMA or even the UFC, but
it
was a really
more,
shining moment.
Yeah. There's a lot more Tank Abbott to come, but almost none of it's going to be good.
I mean, I think we'll talk about it in a little bit, but I think this event actually broke Tank Abbott's spirit. I think that's what it was to me, and after watching this whole event again and seeing... seeing his debut to now consecutively in the order we have, I think this broke his mentality about fighting.
Could be. I mean, it may. I think that slowly, probably the UFC's insistence on really trying to mold him into some sort of, like, to keep him walking a line of some sort. And I don't even know what line they wanted him to walk, because it becomes incredibly blurry with the Ferrozzo interview that follows. You realize just how shittily they're kind of treating Tank. And, I mean, obviously Tank brought a lot of that on himself. I mean, nobody who worked with him seems to like him. He got into fights with a bunch of people. McCarthy seemed, you know, really hated him. Davey hated him. Like, they're just...
His own training partners hated him because, you know, last time we saw Tank, Tito Ortiz was with him, and in this event, there's no Tito, and they already had, I think, had their falling out at this point.
Yeah, so obviously Tank's burning a lot of his own bridges, but at least publicly, and certainly from the Blatnick and Beck side of it, and, you know, I don't know any of their history with Tank, really, but their treatment of him as a public figure seems really, like, weird and focused on him in ways that publicly don't make any sense.
Tank Abbott was really a conundrum in terms of how to market this guy, because he was a guy that was popular. He had some skills, but he was also really out of shape. He didn't look like the average guy. You know, I guess he didn't look like the face they'd want to have in the company, but he was the reason a lot of people came to watch the shows at this point.
Yeah, and I mean, just like, I think that they're pushing him to be more professional probably made him less professional.
That sounds about right for Tank, yeah.
Yeah, that would be my guess, is that, like, he seems like the kind of guy that every rule you threw up at him would make him, like, less likely to follow it.
Tank Abbott is the original bad boy of the UFC.
Yeah, which they tried to label Chemo as in this for reasons that aren't at all apparent to me.
Yeah, maybe we could actually liken Tank Abbott to Poochie from The Simpsons. If you really think about it, he's the original hound from hell. And I'm gonna say Tank Abbott is Poochie.
There you go. Lovely, a lovely comparison for the Tankster.
I think it's fitting.
So yeah, after this fight, we get to this weird, weird interview between Bruce Beck and Scott Ferrozzo.
Yeah, and this was awkward.
Not only was it terribly awkward, but it was very obviously staged from beginning to end. So they basically have Bruce Beck come out and, without having to try too hard, play the stupid, abrasive commentator who's trying to, quote, you know, trying to keep Scott Ferrozzo, the wild bad boy, under control. And then Scott Ferrozzo is there to cut a pro wrestling promo over the top of Bruce Beck and make it look like he's too out of control and too big to be handled by the UFC. And it's obviously super, super staged. It's hard for either of them to keep a straight face through the whole thing. And it's just this weird, like, I don't know, you know, and Scott Ferrazzo says, like, oh, you know, I should be here. There's no reason. The only reason I'm here is because I'm too smart and too pretty, and UFC doesn't want to promote a smart, pretty boy. Like, meaning all this bullshit. And made worse by the fact that immediately after the end of the show, I believe, or later on in the night, Frye reveals that Ferrazzo's not there because he couldn't pass his medicals.
Yeah, which is pretty funny. pretty funny.
Yeah, I mean, Ferrozzo, so it's just very, like I say, you know, mixed in with the UFC, or with Beck and Blatnick very publicly crapping all over Abbott again and again for not being respectful and nice, they then go way out of their way to cut this stupid pro wrestling promo with Scott Ferrozzo to show how disrespectful and rude he is as a way of selling their next, you know, the UFC 12. Because that's all it is. Just a pump-up piece for their UFC 12 pay-per-view.
But if you actually look at how Ferrozzo does this promo, he's not quite the Tank Abbott bad guy. If you actually really kind of analyze how it's put together as opposed to Tank Abbott, you know, this is more of a Ric Flair bad guy promo, because, you know, we have Ferrozzo wearing a suit and sunglasses indoors. And the way he's talking, it's really very much a poor man's Ric Flair kind of promo. And yeah. it's different from Tank Abbott, because Tank Abbott is more like you know, your tough guy, bad guy promo, you know? More like your Austin Idol, maybe, let's say. So that's my take on it. It's still very clearly pro wrestling wannabe.
And yeah, it's super campy.
No. Yeah, very campy, very corny. Does it interest me in watching him fight? Not really, but it is funny as hell to see this happen. It's just like, it just goes to show you how they're trying to market this event and how they're trying to actually build up future shows. Because again, at this point, UFC is in a lot of trouble. And they were trying to go into a whole, it seems to me at least, they were trying to go into a different route to market and sell this event. And yeah. In that case, that meant taking it from the pro wrestling aspect instead of having it as the blood sport aspect. So, cause, you know, we have bad guy Ric Flair, Scott Ferrozzo, tough guy Tank Abbott. And then moving ahead, we also have Dan Severn, who's the all-American babyface, essentially.
Yeah, no, it's definitely like a, and it's sad too, because in the past, the way that they would always build up promos for new shows, or the way they'd build up new shows, would be to talk about talent that they're gonna get. You know, it was like, oh, next show we've got this great new fighter coming out. Maybe we're in talks with this former pro boxer, or. You know, they tease this great new talent that they were bringing out, and suddenly they're bringing up a guy who's, you know, gone win-loss in the UFC, has been fun, but not terribly, like, not so impressive that you're like, oh, God, Scott Ferrazzo, I've got to buy a show for him. And he's the guy that you're, like, leaning heavily on to promote a future show.
I guess part of it is that they're just trying to also build up their characters and build up their own names, because... You know, who's left? I think, you know, they knew what was happening with a lot of the fighters of this show as well, which we're going to talk about in a little bit. You know, we keep saying that. But there's some big stuff that happens at the end of the show. They're really trying to just build up who they had on the roster and who was left on the roster. And Ferrozzo was one of those people, and he spent his interview basically calling out Severn and Tank Abbott, who were at this point also poised to be, like, two of the bigger names in their future shows. So they're trying to go a different route. Instead of teasing new coming people, tease who they already had and make them look bigger and more important.
Yeah, and it was an appalling failure.
Yeah, it didn't work, unfortunately. It was a good effort.
And I can't say it was a failure for viewership, because the numbers didn't fall off for UFC 12 at all. But it just, you know, it certainly didn't do anything me watching it make me want to watch the next one.
I agree. Yeah, it wasn't anything that actually made me care. But it was cool seeing, you know, Ferrozzo legitimately rank on Tank Abbott, because he did that a lot, and we know they have an actual feud at this point. That was at least for real. Like, that was at least some genuine stuff coming out of the promo. The Severn stuff was not. And, you know, Ferrozzo basically saying he wants a shot at the belt and all this and that. That was pro wrestling-y. And we know that, you know, again, Ferrozzo at this point was just, you know, an alternate now. And now he's trying to get back onto the main card, so he's not going to get a title shot anytime soon. But, you know, they're trying to push. I think the best part of the interview... once it was all said and done, was how they had, like, you know, him saying that all the ladies want me, and then they cut to the four UFC ring card girls, and they're all chanting Scott. That was so pro wrestling. It was perfect.
It was so weird. It was so weird.
Like... And then Bruce Beck ruins it once again, because Bruce Beck ruined this whole interview. Let's face it. Bruce Beck is what ruined this interview and ruined this promo. He just didn't know how to handle himself. He didn't know how to be Mean Gene Okerlund here. And all the ladies love him, even though he's married to a lovely woman named Joanne or whatever her name was. It's like, wow, way to shit on the entire promo that went on way longer than it should have.
Yeah, it really, Beck, it's true. Beck really did keep, you know, he kept, oh, God.
He derailed it. He derailed it, I'd say, a few times.
He did. He kept cutting off his own nose to spite his face. Like, he just really, like...
He spent $500 in peanut butter because it was $3 a jar.
That's right. I mean, it's just, you know, that does make me now wonder how you could divide 500 by 3. My math may not have...
Well, there's tax involved, too, so, I mean, I think that's what it is.
That's true. We're not living in a tax-free state here, so...
No. I really want some peanut butter now.
All right. So, this was just terrible. And like I say, all it really did to me was... cast a weird light onto this fact that there was very obviously a lot going on behind the scenes with the UFC's relationship with Tank Abbott and why it was so negative, because they were obviously very comfortable having a heel that treated other talent like crap. They just had to be able to control the rhetoric.
That sounds about right. And Tank Abbott was just really an uncontrollable, I guess we'll call him a force of nature, even though he really wasn't a force of nature in the octagon that often. What he was. You couldn't really predict what he was going to do and what would happen when you saw him in the cage.
Yeah.
Or especially outside of the cage. You couldn't predict who he was going to mug next.
Yeah. So it was a weird moment. Weird. Cast a weird light. I mean, in a lot of ways, Ferrozzo and Abbott are kind of parallel figures in weirdness at this moment because they're very similar fighters who cut a very similar figure and have a very similar outside the cage attitude, but one of them is obviously very much a UFC good guy that they want to build up, and the other one is a guy that they're stuck with.
That would be Tank Abbott. Yeah. So moving ahead now, we go to our next fight, because again, that was our bit of filler, and there's still a lot more filler to come. We move ahead now, and now we have, instead of Chemo Leopoldo, Chemo is out because of his fatigue and dehydration. Mark Hall steps in to take on Don Frye. And I didn't know where to start on this one. I guess I'll start on how once again, Bruce Beck, being Bruce Beck, calls Mark Hall a UFC wannabe champion.
I know. That was so terrible, wasn't it? That was just
Beck is an asshole tonight. I don't know what's up with Beck, but he is not having a good night.
No, that was really bad. Even I heard that. I make fun of Mark Hall for looking like somebody's softball coach. But that's harsh. The dude's getting in there to fight Don Frye, for God's sake. And you're calling him a wannabe champ.
Yeah, I mean, because for a while, they were actually pushing Mark Hall. You can't forget, for a while, he was actually main card, main title card, in fact, at the start of a show. And now he's an alternate. So, I mean, you know, it's not like he's had a huge fall from grace. He's trying to get his way back into the main card again, I guess. But even then, it's not like he was kicked off the main card because he won his last fight he had, I believe. So, I don't get it. But anyway, I mean, and Paul Varlins, by the way, is in Hall's corner because I guess Hall is Nolan as well. So, two loners together, they've made a friendship. It's kind of cute if you think about it. It's like a sitcom.
Yeah, maybe I can just imagine Varlins going up to Hall after Hall's first fight and be like, I could walk out with you, man. I mean, like, I got nothing better to do.
We're both losers. Let's just be losers together.
So, yeah. We got a wannabe champ and a loner walking out with another loner. And they unfortunately also had the bright idea of talking about just how competitive Frye versus Hall 1 was. And kind of building up that this could be a pretty good fight, too. Which,
and it could have been, actually, if, you know, had it not turned out the way it did.
Yeah, had it not been a fixed fight, one of the two UFC fixed fights.
Yeah, I've got a good quote on that. But yeah, the fight itself, you know, Frye gets the softest looking takedown I've ever seen, and it's even worse because they show it in slow-mo, and you basically can see Hall jumping in and pulling guard so he can safely land.
Yeah.
It was just the softest, weakest takedown ever. And then they kind of wrestle a bit on the ground. Well, not really. Basically, Frye stands over him as Hall basically kind of flails his legs, but doesn't really try to defend anything. He just has his legs held against Don Fry's hips. Frye gets an Achilles tendon hold, and Hall just taps out.
The only leg lock of Don Fry's career, by the way.
Ah, that makes sense. And it was not a very good leg lock either, because he even had trouble finishing that in a fixed fight.
Yeah.
And it looked terrible. Hall taps out like it's the end of the world. Like, he's screaming in agony. He even gets carried away at the end of it. But that's probably why he had Varlins come out, actually, to help him make it look more legit, have someone carry him out, because he really played it off like he was hurt so bad. But yeah, as we're saying, this was a fixed fight. And I'm going to read now an excerpt from a book I brought. I'm not pulling out the DVDs again, don't worry, but I actually have with me here Big John McCarthy's book, Let's Get It On. And he actually has a page about this. I want to read this excerpt, if you don't mind, Zane.
Oh, go ahead.
Okay, take a nap. I'll let you know when it's over. All right. Trying to find the spot. He's actually sleeping, folks. This is kind of sad. You can't see it, but he's sleeping. Yeah, this psych gag doesn't work, Zane, unless you, like, tap the mic or something.
I can't tap the mic.
It's just very awkward. I'm just staring here. I'm just staring here very blankly. Try it again. Make a noise, then do it.
All right, here, how about this?
I'm waiting to see how long I can do this before Zane gets pissed and wakes up.
Read the damn book.
All right, fine.
I've got the quote in front of me. I'll just read over you if you want me to.
No, the Wikipedia quote's actually wrong.
Okay.
Yeah, so let me get that page. I got page 215 here, but let's get it on. And he says, unfortunately, this night was the second time I felt I was refereeing a fixed bout. Blah, 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 blah. Okay, so he says, the fight struck me as odd. Frye, a bread-and-butter wrestler and swing-for-the-fences puncher, had never won a fight by leg lock, and Hall practically fell into the submission. I also knew both fighters were managed by the same guy, which they actually do mention in the commentary. They actually do say it. Beck says they're managed by the same guy.
Yeah.
So continuing, I told Meyerowitz afterward that the fight had been fake, but Meyerowitz asked me how I could think that. Rumors that Hall had thrown the fight circulated for months until he came out and openly admitted it. Hall said Frye had offered to pay him with the mutual manager's consent to ensure that Frye made it to the finals as strong as he could be. Hall said he came forward only after Frye didn't settle up, though, and Frye denied it ever happened. So that's pretty much what we have there. And, yeah, so that's actual admission that that was a fixed fight in the UFC. So we have two now. At least two that we know of. So, so it's a total fixed fight, nothing to even speculate about. Big John says it, you know, one of the fighters said it, and I hope that Hall eventually got his money, because that's kind of messed up that he didn't.
Yeah. I mean, I can see why he wouldn't. Like, what's he going to do? Like, how, you know, what does he have to hold over Don Frye if all Frye does is ever does is deny it? It sucks, but that's the danger of taking a dive, is that all the other person has to do is not pay you. That's why you always get your money up front for a dive.
Yeah, exactly. For all you young fighters out there who are hoping to be a pro or make it big, if you're going to throw a fight, make sure you get your money in advance and you get it in cash. So just a little heads up for you. That's advice from the fight nerd and Zane Simon. The more you know.
Because the moment you don't, all the other guy has to do is win and then you can walk away. Because you can say, oh, I took a dive all you want, and people, that just looks bad for you.
Yeah, that's right. So knowing is half the battle, Yojo.
There you go. Oh, man.
So that's pretty much the fight. Nothing to talk about, because it's just a bullshit fight, and it was a really bad-looking fixed fight. And it was, by the way, 20 seconds long. So, again, we're now back to filler, because we have about half an hour to fill before show's over.
And so our filler now, we used to have the UFC training videos, and the UFC, like, I don't know, was the what they called it before. Their fight club thing that they had, where you could get a hat and a t-shirt and have, you know, Rich Goings come over and give you a massage, whatever that club was.
I don't think that was actually, I don't think they had an official fan club. I think you just bought the crap and they gave you some crap.
Okay.
That wasn't an official club. This is now their first actual UFC fan club.
But I love that they're trying to sell it as not just an official UFC fan club. Like, this is a legit fighting association that you, a fan, can join and get a free key patch, or a free, like, patch and key ring and t-shirt.
Don't forget the ID card.
The ID card. Like, you can get your KISS Army card and join the KISS Army. Like, that's what they're trying to sell here. And, like, that fighters might want to join this and fight, you know, under the Ultimate Fighting Alliance, and they have, like, ranking. I want to know, because later on they said this, you know, they pitched it again at us, and they had this whole thing where, like, we have rankings, and we'll have, like, the ability to advance and test and all that. Can we, like, figure out and maybe, like, try and get some people who advanced in the Ultimate Fighting Alliance system?
Yeah, this is, like, basically Ultimate Fighter before it even existed, except that it's not good, so...
there's no show.
Exactly, yeah, and there's nothing that ever came out of it. I don't think Tito Ortiz came up through the Ultimate Fighting Alliance system to get onto the show at UFC 13. So, we're gonna have to Google this later, because I didn't really have a chance to look it up either. I want to see more about this Ultimate Fighting Alliance. It clearly didn't last very long, and it didn't exactly stick. So, yeah.
Yeah, I want to know, like, who went up levels in the Ultimate Fighting Alliance.
We gotta do some interviews and see this, see if we can find out. I want to see the database, actually. I want to see who's on the database list.
Yeah, it's gotta be out there somewhere.
It's probably the same place the American Pit Fighting Championship records are. And so we also, besides the Ultimate Fighting Alliance advertisement, we also had another teaser for UFC 12. And this is actually the most important teaser of the entire night. This one finally tells us what the hell UFC 12 is all about. And it also tells us that it's going to be held in New York, in Niagara, which, if I recall, I don't think UFC 12 was in New York. Zane, you can correct me on that one if you know, but I don't think it was in New York. I'm pretty sure it wasn't.
No, the UFC only ever held one event in New York.
Yeah, and that was UFC 7.
Yeah, UFC 7. This was in Dothan, Alabama.
That's right. I think UFC 12 was the one that actually began the official drama. Yeah, I think that was the one where they actually were forced to move, and it kind of began the... We can call it the official drama over MMA in New York if you want to go that way. But yeah, so we know that. We know that it's now going to be in New York, supposedly, on February 7th, I think it was, or February 6th, 1997. And now we know that the plans are, you know, we know that Severn's going to be competing. Now we do know that he's going to be competing to unify his super fight title with the winner of the Ultimate title from tonight. So yeah. Whoever that's going to be will fight Severn to unify the two belts. So that's exciting news. That's actually a pretty big story. And then the real big story here, and it's going to affect the future of the company, is that as of UFC 12, there are now weight classes. Holy crap, there's weight classes. And to be fair, there are very loose weight classes. We're having a heavyweight class and a super heavyweight class. So heavyweights is 200 and under, and super heavyweight is anything over 200. That is our weight class now. That's not really a big difference, but it makes a difference. It does make a difference. And we're also now having two different tournaments. There's no longer one open weight 8-man tournament. There's now going to be two separate 4-man tournaments in one night.
Yeah, because this event proved pretty clearly, and I'm surprised. So did they make all those announcements during this event?
Yeah, that was actually right before the ad for the Ultimate Fighting Alliance. I don't know if you had that. I guess maybe you might be watching a different version after all then, because mine actually did have that as one lump announcement.
Yeah, I don't remember. Maybe I fell asleep. I may have like tuned out entirely for that.
There was a lot of filler here. It wasn't as bad as what was it? I think UFC 10 for me, or UFC 11. Sorry, it wasn't as bad as UFC 11 because that was awful. But yeah, there was a lot of filler in this one because they had a lot of time to kill, and that's what happened. But it's huge news, and that's we're going to talk more about it at the end of the show as well. Really big change to the company, a big change for the future of Raw, and so that is, I believe, our second to last teaser, but it's basically the most informative teaser of the night. Tells us the whole story. Big changes for the UFC happening at the next event. Big changes for everybody.
I'm really kind of shocked that they actually decided to go away from tournaments, like the 8-man tournaments, before this event, because this event was like a pretty clear indictment of the tournament system doesn't work. Although I suppose 11 was the one where Coleman won by default, so that was an even worse indictment that it doesn't work. And that makes sense, too.
Yeah, I mean, definitely 11 helped reinforce that they needed to stop these one-night tournaments. And if they weren't sure by that event, I mean, this one clearly did. Because, as we said, we're very lucky that, you know, basically two things happened here. Because we had two alternates moving ahead. We're really lucky that Tank Abbott was able to beat the shit out of Nelmark. And we're really lucky that Mark Hall threw the fight. Because if Mark Hall and Don Frye actually fought, I can guarantee someone would have gotten injured. And it might have been... I think Don Frye would have still won the fight. But it would have been a tough fight, and he probably would have hurt himself in the process. And we would have risked not seeing Don Frye move ahead, and we would have gotten stuck with whoever else was left as an alternate fight.
Ty Bowden, Don Frye in the final, or Ty Bowden, Tank Abbott in the final.
We could have had Ty Bowden be the UFC Ultimate Champion. God help us all.
Yeah, I mean, it was a breaking system, so this was definitely an event that kind of confirmed it, even as much fun as it was. And like I say, I think for pure action, it's pretty much the best start-to-finish UFC event.
And it's so far. I mean, we can't deny it's not exciting to see, you know, an alternate suddenly come up out of nowhere and win, but on the other hand, you know, an alternate winning isn't really that big of a deal because he's an alternate, he's crappy, he didn't have to fight two other fights to get there. So, you know, it's good to see the system go away. And to get a more streamlined system, it's a little bit more fair as well. So, you know, that's a good thing. Everybody kind of wins with that one.
Definitely. So, yeah, we get now our last fight of the night.
Oh, you are missing stuff then, because I have more filler.
Oh, what more filler do you have?
All right, so you might have...
Oh, no, I have all this. I have all the Severn shit, yeah. I forgot that we get...
Well, I also have... Before that, we also had a recap of Tank Abbott and Frye's fight so far. I don't know if you saw that. We had a highlight reel of that.
Yeah,
of their fights.
Yeah, we had that. That was pretty pointless. And then we got, like, this... So we had the promo with Scott Ferrozzo, and we knew Scott Ferrozzo and Dan Severn were going to be on the next show. But rather than having Dan Severn come in and do an interview right there with Blatnick or with the other guy,
Beck. Tony Blauer?
Yeah, Tony Blauer or Bruce Beck. They cut to a pre-recorded interview with him that I don't know why they'd pre-record it. I can't. The only thing I can think of watching it was that they had to do like 5 takes to get it right, and so that's why they decided to like pre-record it.
Yeah, it seemed like they were maybe planning to use this for something else, possibly. Yeah. They shot with like multiple cameras as well in a studio kind of setting. They were trying to make it look a little bit more serious. I think again, this is them trying to come into their new era, because especially now that we officially have the news that UFC is headed in a new direction, I think this is again them trying to make Severn look like he's, you know, he's super special. He's the guy we're giving all his attention to because he's the next big star. So I think that's what it was.
And what it really ended up looking like was Blatnick fluffing Severn for several minutes while we waited for the next fight to happen.
It was 10 minutes, by the way. I actually fast-forwarded pretty much almost all of this because it was so boring. It was just Jeff Blatnick getting his dream threesome with 2 Dan Severns and a jar of peanut butter. It was pretty horrible.
Yeah, I mean, and Severn, Severn tries so hard to cut a good promo and to be, like, really catchphrasey. And his voice, like, the faster he talks, the more nasally his voice gets, and the less interesting he gets. And it's just, like, stories about, like, yeah, and we were, like, breaking stuff out in the backyard, and my mom was like, you should go put that wrestling to real use. And so we did.
That was a spot-on Dan Severn impression.
Like, that was this interview.
It was really that bad. It's just 10 minutes of that, and Jeff Blatnick giving him a hand job off camera. It's just awful. It's just Jeff Blatnick saying how much he loves wrestling and how much he loves Dan Severn, and Dan Severn. So it was just awful.
Yeah. And then at the end of it, for some reason, Severn just walks into the cage, like, you know, because this is all pre-recorded, and then they have Severn live walk into the cage with his super fight and heavyweight title belts, do a big Dan Severn arms out robot bear spin, and then walk out of the cage.
And we can't forget that also before that happens, they also show a very quick highlight reel again of Dan Severn to let you know how amazingly awesome he is.
Yeah.
It's just really bad and kills the momentum of the show. It's. I'd say it's worse than Scott Ferrozzo, because at least Scott Ferrozzo had some energy and didn't sound like Lee Allen on steroids.
Yeah, no, this felt like this felt like trying to recut the Scott Ferrozzo promo with Dan Severn, and Dan Severn just forgetting that he had a promo to cut.
That sounds like Dan Severn, all right. Yeah, I mean, he's even in pro wrestling, he was never good at cutting promos, and he's just better off just sticking to actually fighting.
Yeah.
And so speaking of, that's the end of our filler, finally. I think we have like 20 minutes to go in the actual event or something, or 10 minutes to go in the actual event now. And we finally get our last match of the night. Thank God it's two guys that were actually in the main card draw. We have Tank Abbott, Don Frye. This is actually a really great matchup. It's just too bad that it happened after they already fought twice each.
Yeah, it was an awesome... it would be an awesome fight to see for like 15, you know, for like an opening, and just as a fight on its own. Just a straightforward matchup. It'd be a great fight to see. Because Frye, I mean, for being the vastly superior technical fighter, there's one of those things that I saw in this fight, in this card in general, was that, like, we really, you know, as guys are getting technically way better and way stronger and way better trained, except for Tank Abbott, they're also totally lacking in any sort of defense whatsoever.
Especially Don Frye being tired. Like he right away, as soon as this fight starts, like they both come out and Abbott nearly drops him with the jab.
Yeah. And they just got out of the gate, came forward and started wailing on each other. that was this fight, essentially.
A lot of dirty boxing, a lot of swarming of punches, but it was a hell of a throwdown.
Yeah, hell of a throwdown for as long as it lasted. And then, of course, the thing is that because Abbott's not training all that seriously, because he's like 275 pounds, he slips and falls over.
Yeah, that's pretty much how the walls came tumbling down for Tank Abbott, because he slips on the mat, and he was, I'd say he was winning the fight at that point. It was a little hard to say. He was, at this point, more or less winning it.
Yeah, he was winning. This was like, he was ahead in this fight, because he had more one-shot power than Don Frye, and then he slips and falls on the mat.
And then Frye just takes his back and gets the rear naked choke in, and he taps out immediately because Tank Abbott doesn't know how to defend any submission still.
Yep.
And that's our finals, a minute and 23 seconds.
Yep.
Really disappointing ending, unfortunately. And yeah, Tank walks out. He basically leaves the cage because he's so disappointed. And you can understand why, because he was winning this fight. He still looks perfectly fine. Don Frye's face looks like mashed up ground beef. It's a bloody mess.
Yeah.
Abbott really could have had this fight won. And it just didn't work out for him because that damn slip. That's really what did it. If he hadn't slipped, he probably still would have been able to keep the fight standing at least for a little bit longer, because Frye was, even though he had a worked fight and only went 20 seconds, he was rocked and he was tired. And, even though Tank was also extremely exhausted, he was just bigger and landing stronger blows, and that's what was doing it for him.
Yeah, so it was kind of a weird moment. You know, it was a really good fight, but it's just a strange... Like I say, we're talking about this is sort of like the end of Tank Abbott as a UFC great.
Absolutely, yeah. This was, like I was saying, I think this is really what broke Tank Abbott's spirit to keep fighting. He lost his fight that he should have won because he slipped and because he wasn't really trained enough yet. This should have been his night. It actually could have been his night. And he didn't, and I think he just stopped caring at this point, it feels like. And looking ahead at what fights he's going to have, I think he just stopped caring.
Yeah. Ugh, God, it's weird. I'm looking at this, too. He fought for UFC heavyweight title after this. Can you imagine?
I believe he came in as a replacement, actually, in that fight.
Yeah, but even still.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Saying he came in as a replacement doesn't make it better.
Yeah, so that's pretty much our finals. Don Frye wins the Ultimate 2. He gets the belt, and the belt looks pretty ugly, by the way. That belt is a step down from what they had at the last Ultimate. That's an ugly belt.
Yeah, it is. It's an ugly belt. And then they tried to sell us a cobbled-together, not really, not an event, but a highlight reel as a pay-per-view for New Year's Eve.
Ultimate New Year's. 6 hours of UFC action from UFC 1 through 11.
Yeah.
Including four never-before-seen fights.
Oh, jeez. Yeah, I can't... I guess, some prelims. Get some prelims in there.
Yep, we're going to finally see... What was that? I think the Orlando Veit knockout from UFC 2. That was probably on there. Had to have been on there because it was like an actual good knockout. Who knows what else, but yeah. We got that. We also got an interview with Don Frye that isn't really worth mentioning because he's just so damn tired, and he says Tank Abbott was a really good fighter.
Yeah, it was a nice interview with Don Frye. I mean, this is like pre-Don Frye crazy pants.
Yeah, no Don Frye crazy pants yet. And we got Tank Abbott because Tony Blauer caught up with him as Tank was probably trying to leave the damn arena. Blauer gets him and interviews him, and another awkward Tony Blauer interview. And Abbott, yeah, he's pretty humble in the loss, but he's also pretty upset, I can imagine.
Yeah, and this is where he also reveals that Ferrozzo was not on this card because he couldn't pass his medical. So, kind of really undercut the whole promo that Ferrozzo cut, saying that the UFC was too scared to put him in the event.
Yeah, and again, it kind of goes back to what you were saying about how they're marketing Ferrozzo as a new kind of tank, because at least they can control Scott, and you can't control Tank Abbott.
Yeah.
And, and also, once again, Tank says he doesn't respect anybody, including Tony Blauer. He makes a point of saying that.
Yeah, and then immediately afterward, Beck and Blatnick totally shit on Tank Abbott again. After spending the last, 15, 20 minutes building him up as a great fighter that is really actually quite good at fighting, the moment he says that he doesn't respect Don Frye or Blauer, they're immediately like, yeah, well, that's Tank Abbott for you.
And that's how UFC's Ultimate 1996 pretty much ends.
Yep. It's just this terrible weak note of the announcers crapping all over Tank Abbott.
It's like they might as well have just said, oh, and a puppy died outside the arena an hour ago. Good night, everyone.
Yeah, pretty much.
Poochie died.
Poochie died.
He went back home. So, yeah, that was Ultimate 96. It actually is a really good event, though. It's definitely one of the strongest events. Even despite the fact that alternates come in, those alternates, in a way, besides Mark Hall, make the show actually pretty good. You know, the fact that Nelmark got Nelmarked was great, and the fact that Chemo came in, that was still pretty good. It wasn't Coleman. And frankly, had Coleman come in, I mean, we could kind of speculate about that right now. If Coleman was actually in this, he probably would have won.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he almost certainly would have won. I mean, he'd beat Varlins, and then he would have beat
Goodridge.
Yeah, he'd beat Abbott easily. You know, there's nobody in this field that Coleman wouldn't have beat right now.
So, frankly, we were actually pretty lucky that Coleman did get injured. Otherwise, it would have been probably a much longer night as well, and probably not quite as exciting.
Indeed. Well, I got to get out of here. I am just getting a call from my wife, so for the end of UFC Ultimate 96, I'm giving an equally dour down note to an otherwise pretty good show.
Yeah, Zane, if you want to sign off, you can go ahead. I'm going to just wrap it up real quick and run over anything else that's going on with future events. But, yeah, otherwise, we got nothing.
All right, yeah, I got nothing. You have something left for our viewers, but I, as it were, have nothing.
All right, well, Zane, we will see you next time, and we're going to figure out what we're going to do next. That's what I'm going to talk about next. But, Zane, you can peace out. I'm going to wrap up things here.
All right, adios, man.
All right, peace out, yo. Seacrest out.
Seacrest out.
All right, and so Zane is gone, and now just to let you guys know what's happening, that was UFC 12, Ultimate 1996. Really good event, worth checking out. Good show top to bottom. Unfortunately, Zane had to leave, so we don't really get to wrap up things much more beyond that. But, you know, like we said, now this is now the turning point for the UFC. We now have two weight classes, so things are going to start really changing very quickly here for the UFC and the sport itself. We're going to see a change in how fighters are, how the shows are being run. And you're going to see how fast things kind of almost turn into modern-day mixed martial arts. So what is next now for the Old School MMA review? That is to be determined, because really, you know, we've been waiting to get to Ultimate 2 because this is really a milestone event. This is where things really change. Two weight classes now, no more open weight divisions. This is now a new era for the UFC. So we're basically putting this out to you guys who are watching this show is, what do you want to see us do next? We can keep going down UFC road. We might take a little break for a while and do, like, you know, a few one-shots here and there. But beyond that, you know, we can continue on down with some more UFCs. We can maybe go down Pride FC. We might even look at a few Battlecade, maybe some hook and shoot, maybe something else completely different. You know, pretty much it's up in the air right now. So let us know what you want to see us do next, if you want to see us continue down UFC memory lane. Otherwise, we're going to take a little bit of a break as well and figure that out. And an idea we've also been working on is possibly having an awards, fan awards, essentially, for these events that we've watched so far, since we now have pretty much seen, 13 UFCs total, and this is now the end of an era. So we're thinking about maybe doing a fan choice awards for all these events, and we'll determine, you know, what's the best of the best and the worst of the worst in the old school UFC up to this point. So that's pretty much a quick news update of what's going on. Otherwise, that is Ultimate 96. This is the Old School MMA review. That was Zane Simon. I am the Fight Nerd. We'll be back very soon with another review. What it's going to be, the future will tell us very soon. See you guys later.